All right. We got to the first of the year. Can you believe it? Everybody was doing this whole, boy, we can't wait for 2020 to be over. And if we could just turn the calendar, we're going to be better. Well, guess what? We're still dealing with some of the same things today that we were dealing with the last day of the year. It's just the way the world goes. You know, as much as we like to make resolutions and we like to make plans, those are good things to do. Resolutions are only good if we do what? We follow through with them. If I'm going to be a person who's going to be more healthy this year, that means I need to be willing to exercise. I've got to eat better. We hear all that kind of stuff over and over. Next year, I promise, I'm going to lose some weight. I'm going to get more healthy. And we could go through our list of things we're going to do. People are going to quit smoking. They're going to quit drinking. They're going to whatever. But you've got to be willing to commit to that before it can be a reality in our life. I want to start a series of messages today entitled Starting Well. And we're just going to be through the month of January looking at some wonderful advice on living a life well over this next month, just from the Psalms. And we're going to start with Psalm 1 today, and we're just going to look at how it just gets right to the nuts and bolts of how we should be willing to move in this coming year. We don't know what it's going to hold, but we also know that we have a God that's so much bigger than what we are. We also understand that if all else goes away and our God is still there, we've got everything we need. And so I'm thankful for that. A friend of mine some time back shared with me an illustration. And it was an old advertisement for Help Wanted. And here's what it said. Young, skinny, wiry fellas, not over 18. Must be an expert rider, willing to risk death daily. Orphans are preferred. Wages are $25 a week. Now, I don't know about you, but if I were to see some type of ad like that, I would think it was type for military service or some type of special ops or something. But it was actually back from 1860 when they were trying to get the Pony Express going. And they knew it was going to be treacherous. Did you realize that back then to send a half-ounce letter by Pony Express, it would cost you $5? Now, we complain about 50-some cent for a stamp today, and it could go anywhere across the nation. But back then, $5 was a lot of money. And so later they would drop it down to a dollar, which was still a lot of money. At that time, I think the rate of transfer would be about $85 in today's currency. Now, the Pony Express was short-lived because of the telegram coming on and people being able to send messages by wire. But could you imagine having to make a choice that you were going to take your own life in your hands every day you went to work? Now, people in the military know what that's like when you're training for military and in combat. But most people don't think they're going to have to take their lives in their own hands when they get ready to go to work on a daily basis. I'm a minister. Most likely, other than people I may come in contact with, my job is pretty safe. But overall, in a situation like this, you wouldn't think that most people would do that. But I want to talk to you today from Psalm chapter 1 about that make the most of your walk as we get ready to go into 2021. I don't know what this coming year is going to hold. It could be an opportunity of many, many blessings, or it could be more of the same that we've gone through over the last year. I don't know what God has in store for us. All I can do is trust that when I get to the other side of this year, I'm not looking back and say, boy, I sure am glad 2021 is gone. I saw a lot of little memes and things like that on social media. People were saying, I can't wait for 2020 to be gone. And other people said, well, just wait. It's now turning 21. It's fully grown now. We never know what's going to happen. We don't. All we can do is say, God, as I walk in this world and as I walk this life, I'm going to be as faithful as I possibly can to you going forward. And so in the Psalms, we get some great advice on how to make the most of your walk. So today's thought is just that. First of all, commit to make wise choices in this coming year. Listen to what the psalmist says in Psalm 1, verses 1 and 2. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. There's some great advice to start out with for this coming year, isn't it? Stay steady with God. You know, the writer gives us three stages of worldly influence in our life. We shouldn't walk into counsel of the wicked. Now, this speaks about the way that we're going to go along in our daily walk. There's no particular close association implied with anyone. What it really is saying, though, if you don't watch out, it's easy to get pulled into things that are not godly. We see it all the time, don't we? We see things that are promoted and encouraged in today's lifestyle and society that we would have never thought would happen. And so people, over and over again, we find out that we begin to walk in the counsel of wicked, because who makes the decisions? And then we just throw our hands up as Christians and say something, well, this is just the way things are today. We've just got to learn to accept things. I was having a conversation with a woman this past week, and she's dealing with a daughter who's nearly 21 now, and she's making some decisions that maybe mom's going to struggle with. But as a result of that, and the conversation that mom had with her daughter, here's what she was told, and I've heard the same thing from my own children. Well, that's just the way things used to be. You know, you're older. People don't do that like that anymore. Have you ever heard that from your children? You know, regardless of what takes place in the world, if we walk with God, God doesn't change. And all we can do is hold tight to His Word. And so this writer has given us these three stages of worldly influence. And we need to ask ourselves whose counsel we're listening to. Now, some people like to read their horoscopes or consult a psychic in some way. Many people will turn to TV shows or social media that's influencing them today. And then some people are just listening to their friends for terrible advice. You know, when Trey was in school, and I'm not picking on him, often I would say, well, how's your assignment? When is this due? He says, they said it was going to be due Friday, but my friend said that they didn't think they were going to be taking that up this Friday. It may be one day next week. And you say, well, what did the teacher say? Well, I don't know, but my friend said. And you say, but did you ask the teacher when it was going to be due? Have they changed the due date for it? Well, no, but in talking with my friend, well, guess what? Friday came and the assignment's due. And my friend was wrong. Have you ever had that happen in your life? Have you ever been given such terrible advice by somebody, and yet you thought that they were looking out for your best interest and you were doing the right thing, and all along they were leading you down the wrong path? So we need to be careful about who we're listening to, because not everyone gives good counsel. We shouldn't stand in the way of sinners, he says. That implies there's more involvement with the sinners. Now, it's not simply just listening to the counsel that's going on and listening to all the noise and buzz that's taking place around us in the world, regardless if it's on the news or social media or people or circles we're running in. But now we begin to get closer to this group of people. We're just hanging out with them. We're just in their vicinity. And as a result of that, they begin to influence us. And so we begin to do the things that they do. We begin to talk the way that they talk. We begin to act the way that they act. And we begin to think more like they think. Well, finally, we're sitting in the seat of mockers. We've gone from just listening and hearing the counsel. We've gone from just being in their proximity that now we are really hanging out. We're one of the crowd. And we've wholeheartedly joined in with those who are not walking in the way of God. You know, we've gotten too comfortable at this point. We found the place where we think we just belong. Nobody else understands me, but this group of people or this person does. And now we're hanging out and going right along with them. You know what I've learned over my life and in my time of ministry? I don't think many people just start out wanting to get in trouble. Now, don't get me wrong. There may be some air of mystique or some stimulating thought about, man, what would happen if you see a police officer. I had a friend of mine one time says, I wonder what would happen when, you know, he got pulled over and he ended up with a warning ticket for a headlight. But he says, you know, as we were sitting there, it made me really feel uncomfortable. He said, I wonder what would happen if I just sped off right here. Would he get mad? And I'm like, don't go anywhere. Don't go anywhere. You know, I'm sitting there being the voice of reason. He said, well, I weren't planning to go. I'm just wondering. You know, what he was thinking, I wonder what it would be like to be the bad boy one time. Most people maybe have those thoughts, But it's wise not to follow through with them. You know, and so he says, be careful that you're not sitting in the seat of mockers. I don't think there's many drug addicts who have started out saying, you know what, I think today I want to become a drug addict. I'm going to start doing cocaine or heroin or the next bad drug. Or I'm going to begin drinking today, and I'm just going to drink to the point where I'm hooked on it, and I want to become an alcoholic. Not many people start out that way, but too many people find themselves there. That's the progression we've seen here, isn't it? We've listened to the wrong counsel. We've hung around the wrong people, and now we are becoming one of them. And no one intends on leaving the Lord. I can't tell you the number of people over the years that I've been in ministry who've said, I've gotten away from God. I used to have a close relationship with the Lord, but I've gotten away from Him, and I don't know how to get that back. But it was a gradual thing that took place. Obviously, God didn't leave you. You had to leave Him. You had to make a choice. And that walk you're making every day, as you're trying to make the most of your walk, you made it in the wrong direction. But those little steps that you take lead you further and further away from Him. And eventually it'll cost you. The Bible says it could cost us our very soul and our salvation. So honestly, we need to be careful about not taking those first steps. And if we're finding ourselves this year in the wrong place and heading in the wrong direction, this is a good time to start moving in the right direction. Godly influences are there if we're willing to just look for them and follow them. Our delight needs to be in the law of the Lord and nothing else. In this coming year and in this new year that we're finding ourselves in now, we need to make the most of the walk that God has been blessing us to have in this coming year. Our delight is in something that gives us great pleasure, and that should be Him. There are plenty of books and about the Bible that are out there, but let me encourage you this year to be reading your Bible. I think the problem we run into with Scripture is that there are so many people writing a good thought or a good word, as we like to hear the terminology thrown out there, about the Bible and about Scripture, that we're not actually reading the Scripture. We'll read somebody else's thought on John 3:16. And we say, oh, well, it had the Bible in it. But now we've got 300 pages of another person's thought on John 3:16. Why not read what the Scripture says about itself and then use those things as supporting advice toward the Scripture? But too many times, we like to fall into the trap of listening to man's words. This past week, a minister friend of mine in Greenville, they were having a minister's luncheon. And the one that was speaking encouraged all the other ministers to say that, he says, in this coming year, instead of quoting some famous author of some sort, why not quote yourself? Why not spend enough time in the Scriptures that you can quote yourself coming in this new year? You know, it's great that you say, well, so-and-so would name drop and we throw a quote down. But what's wrong with reading Scripture and putting it out there in a way that people says, I can hang on to that. I'm not going to walk in the counsel of evil. I'm not going to hang around with those who will lead me astray. And I'm not going to become one of those people. That would be good advice, wouldn't it, for the coming year? And I wonder if we realize the benefit of God's Word in itself. God's Word doesn't contain anything that would not be a blessing for us. It has all the information we need to really succeed in life. And so if we're going to do that, let's commit to make wise choices in this coming year. He's going to give us great advice on how to be the best Christian we can be, the best father, the best mother, all the relationships that we're involved in. We can be the best that we can possibly be in them. We can have the greatest marriage. We can do good in our finances because we're listening to wise counsel. We can have great moral instruction as we walk forward in this coming year. Whatever you're facing, you'll find the answer for it in the Bible. So trust God as you read. Secondly, be a producer and not a consumer. I think for many of us, we find ourselves more in the consuming aspect of life. I mean, you just think about it. You go to a restaurant, you place your order. What do you really want to do? You want to consume. You didn't go in there and say, you know what? How can I be a blessing to this restaurant today? I think I'll be a patron there, and I'm just going to give them money, but I'm not really going to eat the food. I just want to go and order a plate and walk out. No, we go there because we are consuming. And I think for many of us in this world, we, even in the church, we become consumers and not producers. We're not finding a way to replicate and reproduce what it is to be a Christian in the world around us for things that we're learning within the church. Now, the church is a great place to come and get advice and to grow and to know what we need to be doing as a Christian in the world, but then we must put it into practice. And for many of us, we spend more time consuming than producing. Well, listen to what verses 3 and 4 say of Psalm chapter 1. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so with the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Now, the righteous are like a tree planted by the water, it says. The righteous are fruitful people. Notice the righteous are producers. They're a source of good things. They're not ones who are just taking, but they're introducing and helping in some way. And so ask yourself, am I a producer or a consumer in the church? Or are you giving and providing for others, or are you just here for what you can get out of a service on a weekly basis? John Piper described the fruitful this way. They are refreshing and nourishing to be around. You go away from them fed. You always are strengthened. You go away with your taste for spiritual things awakened. Their words are healing, convicting, encouraging, deepening, and enlightening. Be around them. Being around them is like a meal. Now, that's a big thing to think about. There are many different ways and different kinds of fruit that can be bared. I mean, you think about the fruit of the Spirit that comes to mind in Galatians chapter 5. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, long-suffering. We can go right on through it, couldn't we? But there are other kinds of fruit that can be bore within the church. Spiritually, we should be getting better. And we should be getting stronger. And as we are growing, we should then be reproducing. You know, most trees and plants, when you put them out initially, their initial thing is to do what? Establish a root system and begin to grow. But eventually, once they get their root system established, and they're now able to feed themselves and take care of themselves and draw the nutrients from the things around them, most all will reproduce. They don't just sit there and become this and eventually go away. Man, there's these two old, decrepit-looking gumball trees next door to my house in my neighbor's yard. And day before yesterday, we were out in the yard, and I happened to look up. And those two trees are hanging so full of those balls. And it's my favorite time of the year, because the leaves have now fallen, and I know what's coming next. Those balls. Now, it's one thing to go out there with your blower and blow the leaves up in a pile and get rid of them. But it's quite another thing when there's just like, as little as these trees are, I mean, they're diseased and they're broken down, but they are just hanging so full. It's almost like you can't see through them for the balls. I think it's the trees just antagonizing me. I think they're just like, just see how many we can bear for him this year. Because when they fall, they don't fall straight down. Now, the wind's going to blow them, and this time of the year, it blows from my neighbor's end of the street to my side of the road. And so you come out in a good windstorm like we've had, they'll be on your steps. They'll be on your front porch. They'll be on your driveway. It's almost like walking on marbles. You've got to get them up. Or you walk across the yard, and you don't see them, and you're turning your ankle and twisting. And you're like, man, I just got to get these things up. But you know what? That tree was planted. It was put there by God to do what? Reproduce. It's going to reproduce. And so every one of those little balls is actually a seed pod. Can you imagine how many gum trees could be coming out of that one decrepit looking old tree, though it's broken down just from them balls, if they were to take root? And you and I as Christians need to understand something. We're going to do a lot of seed planting. We're going to be dropping a lot along the way. Some people are going to love it. They're going to look at it and say, boy, look at all the seeds they've got. Look at how many pods of seeds that they're growing. But other people, they're just going to fall. They'll never take root. But don't give up in being a producer. Keep producing what God called you to produce. Always walk with what God called you to walk with and trust that he will give the increase when the time comes. You know, those two trees are going to get come down. Thank the Lord, my neighbor said, I'm taking these trees down. They're in bad shape. But I might plant something else there. I hope he does. I say reluctantly, but I hope it's not another gum tree. And I hope another sapling don't spring up between now and the time that they take those two down of the same kind of tree. But if it is, that's what God intended for it to be growing at that time in this place in our history. So I thank God that he's willing to let that happen in my life. No matter what's going on in my life, maybe you think, man, he's just producing the same thing over and over again. Or maybe we're not producing as much. But God says, just keep walking, keep producing, and not simply be a consumer. He says the righteous prosper. So are you righteous? Maybe we're not producing everything we should and prospering because we are not as righteous as we should be in walking with the Lord. Now, this has nothing to do with money and possessions. It has nothing to do with power or position, but it has everything to do with a relationship with God. Mark chapter 8, verse 36, Jesus asked these words. He says, what does it prosper a man to gain the whole world and lose or forfeit his soul? Now, worldly possessions are great. There's not many of us who say, hey, look, just let me live the pauper's life. But if that's what God called us to do, we would have to do it. But then what are we using those resources for? The psalmist says, and he speaks about true prosperity in Psalm chapter 34, verses 19 through 22. It says, a righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all of his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil will slay the wicked. The foe of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems his servants. No one will be condemned who takes refuge in him. Now you could go read Psalm 73 and you could see even a bigger picture of what he's describing here in Psalm 34. But we need to be careful that we don't forget what that big picture is. God says remain righteous, remain in a right relationship with me, because he tells us right here the wicked are like chaff. They're going to be blown away. It may look like something good is taking place right now in their life, but eventually God says they will be blown away. There's going to be a time where God's going to separate us as wheat and tares. There's going to be a time where we're going to be separated from all the things that are not going to be clean in our life. And if we're righteous, we go to be with Jesus. But if we're not, we'll be thrown out like chaff. You see, there's no staying power in those who walk in the counsel of the wicked. Those who do not walk in righteousness, God says, cannot stand. So commit to make right, wise choices in this coming year as you try to make the most of your walk. Be a producer and not a consumer. And finally, make sure you have firm footing. Listen to verses 5 and 6. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. In other words, let me ask it this way. How will you be judged? When you have to stand before God, how will you be judged? He says the wicked will not be able to stand. That means none of the excuses that have been given up to this point will work for them anymore. Just think about the excuses people give for not serving the Lord. Sunday's my only day to sleep in, you know. But how many times and how often do we really sleep in until noon? I couldn't get to church because I was sleeping in. It's almost like we force ourselves to lie in the bed that long. You know, well, I couldn't get up and get ready to go to church today because I slept in. Or I can't stand to be in crowds. And there are people who really deal with situations where they have a hard time being in crowds. But I invite those type of people to come sit up front. You know why? You can't see the crowd. They're all behind you. You know, and you're right up front. The only person that's going to be there is me and those four or five people that may be standing in front of you helping leading in worship. So join me down front next Sunday. Or, you know, people may say something to the effect of, you know, well, there's nobody here my age, or the preacher, he's too loud, or he's too soft. Oh, by the way, Diane, I want to pound on the pulpit for you. She told me to make sure I did that today. She needed to be woke up. So I forgot about that. So now, maybe for some, that was too loud. Maybe for others, you say you're too boring or just not, you move too much or not enough. You see how things can go. We can use all kinds of excuses, can't we? We need to say, God, I want to make sure my footing is sure. I want to walk with you and use any means possible that I can. You see, none of those excuses will cut it when the Lord returns. We've got to be ready when he shows up. On the day, if you try to give him those same tired excuses, guess what's going to happen? He's going to say, yeah, those don't work with me. I love you, but depart from me. I never knew you. Be careful that we don't go down that road. We will all have to give an account of the things that we've done in this life and in this body. There's not one person here in this room or watching from home that will be blameless. No one is. That's the reason we need such a advocate as Jesus there before our Heavenly Father on a daily basis, interceding for us for the sins that we've committed that are not pleasing to God. But the Lord will watch over those who are righteous in His eyes. And those of us who accepted Jesus, who have surrendered to Him and what He has done for us on the cross, the Bible says that He views us as righteous. And the only correct answer on the day of judgment that we will be able to give won't be, I was too tired to get up and go. It's that I belong to Jesus. So make the most of your walk this year. Everywhere you go, let somebody know that you belong to Jesus and you will walk with Him. And only those who are faithful and committed to the Lord have any hope whatsoever, no matter what this year may hold. I pray it will be the best year we've ever had. But even if it's not, Lord, have mercy if it is worse than the one we just come through. I belong to Jesus. And today is the day that you need to decide. You need to make your decision today regarding your eternity, regardless if you are here today or you are home watching. You need to make a decision to follow Jesus. A devotional, Our Daily Bread, a number of years ago, contained this following story. Now, I don't know whether it's true or not, but I think it makes a good point. It says a certain courthouse in Ohio stands in a unique location. Raindrops that fall on the north side of the building go into Lake Ontario in the Gulf of St. Lawrence, while those falling on the south side go into the Mississippi River and the Gulf of Mexico. At precisely the point of the peak of the roof, just a gentle puff of wind determines the destiny of many raindrops. And that's all it is for you and I. There are too many things in our world. It only takes just a little bit of nudging one way or the other to make up your eternal destiny. Make sure you're following the one who will get you home. I'm thankful as I was able to preach Miss Kathleen Stahl's funeral this week. It's easy to preach about people who have gone to be with Jesus and lived their life in accordance to that. The Bible says a tree is known by its fruit. And there wasn't much good, bad fruit that I think was born by her. Do you? She bore a lot of good fruit. That's what he's talked about here, hasn't he? Be like that tree planted by the stream, the one who will give its fruit in proper season. But you have to make a choice. So let me ask you, are you making the most of your walk? Are you making right choices? Are you producing more for the kingdom than you are consuming? And are you on a firm footing with the Lord? In just a moment, I'm going to pray, and then our worship team will come back and lead us in a final song. But if you've not found yourself on firm footing for this coming year, let's do that today. Let's don't start this year on the wrong foot. Let's be where we need to be as followers of Jesus. Let's be prepared that no matter where we are, that we can tell people, I belong to Jesus. And when I get to heaven, that's all that God's going to really ask me to be accountable for. I've trusted the blood of Jesus to cover my sins. I have walked with Him. I believe every word He ever spoke. And I've tried to live my life as close to as I possibly could to the commands He's given me. And so as we get ready to have this time, I'm going to be praying. And if God is moving in your heart, I pray that you will respond in this time. Father, thank you. Thank you for what you're doing in our church. We praise you for being a body of believers who can preach Jesus we've been given a whole fresh start. We pray we're going to start well. And as we look into the Psalms over this month, God, you're going to give us advice on how we should be wandering and staying away from sin, as we've looked at today, to even when we go through some of our darkest moments individually, that you can bring us through them if we just trust you. You're always with us. But in this moment, you're right here, and you want to be with us. You want to walk with us. You want us to be where we need to be with you in a right relationship. So, Father, today, I pray that we're just that. We're making these commitments within our hearts right now. We need to make a public decision to follow Jesus or recommit our lives or rededicate our lives. If we need to be baptized into Christ, we're going to do it. We're going to start well, and we're going to stay true to the course. So, Father, we pray we can do that today. And as our worship team leads us, Father, will your Spirit move us. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen.